Hi. Today's South Dakota adventure takes us to the summer White House. The only president of the United States to stay more than 24 hours in South Dakota was Calvin Coolidge. Coolidge spent nearly 3 months here at the Game Lodge in Custer State Park back in the summer of 1927. And on today's South Dakota adventure, we'll discover why that visit was so important to South Dakota's future. First, let's set the stage. The first 20 years of the 20th century, from 1900 to the end of World War I, can be called a golden age in South Dakota history. Well, for starters, there were more of us South Dakotans than ever before, 401,570 people to be exact. The Depression of 1893 was over, and farmers were getting better prices for their crops. And since prices were stable, farmers could plan better and realize better production. And anytime South Dakota's farmers do well, well, the state is sure to benefit. The success of South Dakota's farmers brought other industries to the state. Because of the flourishing livestock industry, John Morrell and Company located their meatpacking plant in Sioux Falls in 1909. South Dakota's pride in agriculture was responsible for the Corn Palace in Mitchell. While there were other corn palaces in South Dakota, the golden age of agriculture found its home in 1902 at Mitchell, and it's been there ever since. The turn of the century also brought good times to other South Dakotans. The gold mines of the Black Hills boomed like never before. Homestake at Lead mined more than $4 million worth of gold in a year. And there were a dozen other mines doing nearly as well. Miners made $3 a day for a six-day work week. They were the best paid miners in the entire American West. The loggers and sawmills and railroads which supplied the miners were busy too, and towns in the Black Hills grew. The years from 1900 to 1920 were busy and prosperous for the railroads. For years, South Dakotans had wanted a railroad reaching all the way across the state, from the Sioux River to the Black Hills. And sure enough, we didn't get one, we got two railroads. The Chicago and Northwestern built from Pier to Rapid City, and the Milwaukee Road built to Rapid City from Chamberlain. Both railroads were finished in 1907. South Dakota served as the starting point for the biggest railroad project of all, the Milwaukee's Pacific Extension. In 1905, the Milwaukee decided to build a line from the Missouri in South Dakota to the Pacific coast, some 1,400 miles of new track. At the time, it was the biggest railroad project in the country. Thousands of people worked on the line, and some of the bridges they built across the Missouri were the biggest structures in the state. The new railroads brought a number of other changes to South Dakota. Aberdeen became the headquarters for the Milwaukee Road between Minneapolis and Montana. A huge roundhouse and depot offices were built near huge livestock yards where cattle could be fed and watered before being shipped east. And the hub city became even more of a railroad town than it already was. But the biggest change that the new railroads brought was on the West River prairies. Until the railroads came, this land was thinly settled, open range. Much of it was on the Indian reservations. Cattlemen owned huge ranches and then, in addition, leased more land on the Indian reservations to graze still more cattle and sheep. Well, the new railroads changed much of this. By 1905, when the railroads began building west of the Missouri River, there was little land left for homesteading anywhere in the American West. When the railroads built across the Missouri and the federal government opened parts of the reservation to settlers, thousands of people came to South Dakota to seek land. In fact, there were more settlers than there was land for them to settle. Homesteaders waited in long lines at land offices to get the acreage of their dreams. When the land rush came, towns grew up overnight along the rail lines. Faith, Isabel, Kadoka, Presho, Wall, and Phillip were all built to serve the newcomers. In many ways, this West River land rush was like the Dakota boom that brought settlers East River in the 1880s. This second Dakota boom lasted as long as the farm prices were good and the land held out, until America entered World War I in 1917. While the railroads were instrumental in opening up the West River region, by 1900, some South Dakotans began to question the railroad's behavior. Some felt their freight and passenger fares were too high. Others felt railroad officials had too much political influence in the state. People in other states began asking the same questions. The people asking the questions were called progressives. And this period in Dakota history is called the Progressive Era. Most of South Dakota's progressives belonged to the Republican Party. In 1906, they elected Coe Crawford as their governor. They were able to pass a number of laws which controlled the railroads and increased the taxes the railroads paid in South Dakota. The progressives believed that the people didn't have enough influence on politics in the state. So they passed a law which allowed the citizens to directly elect their U.S. senators. Before this, senators were chosen by the state legislature. Eventually, leaders of the progressives became involved in other issues. Peter Norbeck, our first native-born governor, served from 1917 to 1921. He was instrumental in drafting legislation that controlled child labor, provided hail insurance for farmers, created workmen's compensation plans, and established the state cement plant in Rapid City. Governor Norbeck is also responsible for creating Custer State Park in the Black Hills. And today, Custer State Park remains one of the largest and most beautiful state parks in the United States. Norbeck was governor when women were allowed to vote for the first time in South Dakota in 1919. One of the things that changed South Dakota most as the Progressive Era and the Golden Age of Agriculture drew to a close was World War I. Although the war was fought against the Germans and Austrians in Europe, thousands of miles from South Dakota, our state's people were involved in many ways. Some South Dakotans joined the Army or the Navy. Others moved to other states to work in factories that made weapons for war. People who stayed behind in South Dakota became an important part of the war effort, too. You see, our allies, the British and the French, needed food for their armies. German submarines sank many ships carrying food to the British and French. When the United States entered the war in 1917, President Woodrow Wilson asked farmers to do all they could to grow food for our allies. And that put South Dakota farmers and ranchers right in the middle of the war effort. To help farmers achieve this goal, Congress created the Food Administration, headed by Herbert Hoover. Hoover believed that farmers would do their best if they had good prices and good markets. So he promised the Food Administration would buy all the wheat and the few other crops that farmers could grow. He also guaranteed prices. Spring wheat was guaranteed at $2.21 a bushel. In the 2 years from 1917 to 1919, South Dakota farmers increased the number of acres planted by one-third. Almost every spare acre East River was in production. West River homesteaders broke new ground to put more acres on the line. With good crops and high prices, South Dakota farmers and ranchers never had it so good. In 1919, South Dakota had the second highest income per person in the 48 states. The future seemed bright for South Dakota as the state entered the decade of the 1920s. The Roaring 20s, American prosperity at its peak. People couldn't have enough fun in the 20s. There were new Model A cars, Babe Ruth's 60 home runs in one season, Lindbergh's solo flight from New York to Paris in the Spirit of St. Louis. And there were those flappers. Everybody was happy and had plenty of money. Well, almost everybody. After entering the decade with such promise, South Dakota had to face some difficult questions in the 20s. Some of these problems were solved, and some were not. What happened to change the bright future South Dakota seemed to face in 1920? The best place to begin is to explore what happened to South Dakota farmers and ranchers. The good times of the Golden Age of Agriculture and World War I also created some problems in the long run. As we've discovered, South Dakota farmers and ranchers, like their neighbors, had increased the production of their crops and livestock all through the era. And that was fine for a while. Our population was growing, and there were more people to feed. During World War I, submarines kept farmers in Argentina, Australia, and New Zealand from sending their crops to Europe. So American and Canadian farmers had the market all to themselves. When the war was over and the seas were safe, everything changed. Suddenly, the world market was flooded with wheat, corn, livestock, and many other farm products. Since the Food Administration was no longer buying farm products at high guaranteed prices, there were no more buyers. In 6 months, from May to December of 1920, the price of a bushel of spring wheat fell from $2.21 to 90 cents a bushel, and other prices fell too. And by 1921, farmers were complaining about a surplus. There were more farm products than could be sold at decent prices. The sudden fall in farm prices created all sorts of problems for South Dakota farmers and ranchers. Many of them had borrowed money during the war to increase production. Now they had to pay back their loans at a time when they were getting less than half the price their livestock and crops had brought during the war. In addition, farming and ranching were becoming more expensive. New tractors and farm machinery cost much more than the older horse-drawn equipment. And because they believed in the state's future, farmers and ranchers and other citizens had voted to increase taxes for schools and roads. Now the taxes were hard to pay with farm prices so low. The people in cities and towns who sold to farmers and provided services for them suffered too. There was less money available to pay doctors, lawyers, and teachers. As passenger and freight traffic on the railroads declined, the railroads began to lose money. What could South Dakota do about these problems? Well, after the reforms of the Progressive Era, it seemed as if the state should try to do something. South Dakota could not raise farm prices, but it might do other things to keep farmers in business. The state made several attempts to help back in the 20s. In 1923, the state went into the gasoline business. Eventually, the Supreme Court ruled the state could not sell gasoline. A more serious problem was caused by the fact that many banks in the state were running out of money. In 1917, the state had established a system of rural credits to help farmers expand production. Now the Rural Credit Department was unable to collect many of the loans which farmers and banks had made. When the farmers and banks went broke, the state had to assume the debt. It wasn't until 30 years later, in the 1960s, that the state paid off all the debts from the 20s. And South Dakotans said, never again. And today, there are strict limits on the amount of money the state can borrow. Miners in the Black Hills had hard times too. While the price of gold remained the same, the cost of mining had skyrocketed. Only three mines remained open in the early 20s, the Homestake, Bald Mountain, and Trojan mines. Now, there were some things the state did that were successful. In the early 20s, the state opened a cement plant in Rapid City. But farmers needed more than low-cost cement to save their farms. But the operation has remained a profit maker for the state even 50 years later. Some people believed that the way to help South Dakota out of its hard times was to find a new industry. And that new industry would be tourism. And to some South Dakotans, it seemed the tourist industry was the only way to bring back the good times. The major problem the South Dakota tourist industry faced was that too few people knew what a nice place South Dakota was. The state needed some way to make people all over the country sit up and take notice. Something that everyone would recognize as South Dakota's alone. Well, in the summer of 1927, that dream was begun. South Dakota played host to President Calvin Coolidge for 3 months while he worked and vacationed in the Black Hills. Senator Peter Norbeck invited Coolidge out, and he stayed in the game lodge from June through September. Norbeck was able to get Coolidge to dedicate a brand new project in the Black Hills, the carving of Mount Rushmore. With the publicity generated by the president's visit and dedication of the project, sculptor Gutzon Borglum was able to begin the work that today stands alone as a symbol uniquely South Dakota's. All in all, it seems everybody got what they wanted from President Coolidge's visit. He had a nice, inexpensive vacation in the Black Hills. He could claim firsthand knowledge of the farm problem, and South Dakota's tourism business received millions of dollars of free publicity. Oh, and Mount Rushmore got the president's blessing. As farmers and ranchers struggled through the 20s, perhaps the tourism industry could lead the state back to prosperity. Now, while the new president, Herbert Hoover, promised Americans they were closer to triumph over poverty than ever before, South Dakotans would look back over the 20s as a difficult decade. The future did not look as bright as it did in the golden years before World War I. But South Dakota was a good place to live. The people were honest and hardworking. And the air? Well, it's still fresh and clean. Maybe the 30s would bring the return of the prosperous days before the war. And maybe they wouldn't. That's our next South Dakota adventure.